By invoking the, as per our tradition, a long tradition from the Vedic times, the blessings of the God or Goddess of knowledge and wisdom. I think it is this tradition by which we started recognizing the importance of our entire system in which we are embedded. The climate system, the weather system, the earth system, and the universe. Friends, it's a great privilege, sir, to be part of this celebration, a Foundation Day celebration of a very, very important research institution of our nation. Professor Ravina Nanjuniya, Dr. Shetty, Satish Shetty, whom I had known from the as a director of NIO several years back, and also as a Vice Chancellor of the Goa University, and also very distinguished scientist of India. Several very revered persons are present today who have been the director of this prestigious research institution, who have been members of the Governing Council, are members of the Governing Council, very distinguished people who have built this institution of repute. Distinguished scientists of IITM and also distinguished environmental scientists who are present today. So it's a great pleasure for me, really, I must say that. So, because I have been connected with supercomputing 3 decades back, I remember. And supercomputing and climate and weather have been intimately linked. As was announced, and you are very well aware of this one, the countries we are very proud of, the Prithvi system, most powerful supercomputer of our nation, and most powerful, one of the most powerful supercomputing infrastructure of the world, is now installed in IITM. I have not visited that, and it will be my pleasure really to see that system. Most importantly, I think it has been made operational. It has been made operational, and this infrastructure, and we have proven to the world, and we have proven to ourselves that how we intimately link is our ability of weather prediction and climate prediction or climate change understanding is high performance computing. Friends, I would like to bring to your notice, as I was thinking about this, that one of the most important questions before our nation, before the world today, or the whole humanity, is the impact of climate change. We started feeling it as the century was approaching. Climate change became one of the most important questions. And particularly, I remember the book that came out from Sir Martin Rees, President of the Royal Society of London, and when he said, and he boldly said, and which almost shocked the entire world, that this may be, the coming century, may be the last century for the humanity. And this really shocked many people, because, and he wrote a book on that. And one of the things which could contribute to the being the last century was the issue of climate change. So we can see that how important the issue of understanding climate or weather is for the entire humanity. In our own context, I remember that I was being in country of farmers, agriculture, 68% people depend for their livelihood on agriculture. And you know how, but I have faced and we have seen, we are again and again faced as the drought, as the problem of rains, all the farmers looking towards the sky. So when will the rains come? When will the rains come? This issue come, and we think then again the weather prediction becomes, or the monsoon prediction becomes one of the most important concerns of you. Today we are going through the same concern for Maharashtra and this part of the world. So when will the rains come? How will be the rains this year? What will be the issue of the rain? Will we get drinking water or not? This is the major concern we have seen again and again, and we have gone through that this process again and again, this one, that very survival. I think all technological advancement, all advancements are okay, but will we get water to drink? This is the question before us. So the climate prediction is very important, and what we can do, how can we mitigate that? Further question, I think I'm very happy that now IITM is taking the task of also understanding weather, not only understanding, but can we modify, can we do something? Can we mitigate the situation some way or the other? Are there methods of things? And some people have come to conclusion that science currently, because there are some local solutions available, but science does not have enduring solutions, lasting solutions for this problem as we understand today. And we need to understand that. Friends, one thing we have understood is that climate is a global phenomenon. I think good that in 1992 with the Earth Summit and several summits were there, and how important it would be, and this is a whole problem, is a global problem, it is not restricted to one country or one part or one continent, and we must all converge together to understand this problem and solve the problem and do something about it. So, and then several summits were organized, one after another. The Rio and Rio Plus 20 and the current summits which are there, again we come out with some plan at a global level. Thank God we at least come out with some plan, some wisdom about it, and start doing something, but we are not doing enough. Everybody recognizes that the nations or the countries are not doing enough until it hurts you. But we see that kind of thing, that we will survive in order. How many continents or how many, sorry, cities of the world will submerge? We don't know. Until it starts happening before us, we say it's not happening to me. This is the question, and it's for this reason it's very important that the scientists really can think that now it is happening, this is happening, this is likely to happen, predict the climate change issues and how they will impact the humanities and the whole this whole planet itself. This has become important, and that's why I say that IITM is a very, very important institution. For me, IITM is one of the most important things that I think the scientists can really hear and also suggest what should we do. Not only that, now the time has come that okay, the climate is going to change like this, or the weather is going to change like this, or the predictions are going to be like this. What can we really do? I think we need to scientists now go on to, I think, doing and taking action about and suggest ways and means by which the humanity and the world and the planet can survive. Friends, I recognize, I see this in this process, that how were ancient rishis really looked at our planet? Looked at the universe itself. How profoundly they looked at nothing. You look at nothing, we talked about that, we never talked about it in local context. We talked about the Panchamahabhutas. I think everybody is familiar with this thing, the Vedic time, Panchamahabhutas. This one, and how did we come out with this model of Panchamahabhuta? I think it's a challenge to scientists and challenge to me. And how did we come out? Prithvi, Aap, Tej, Vayu and Akash. Look at that model, how that model was that. And how they interact with each other. How this can happen, how they are composed of, the whole thing, the whole universe is composed of this Panchamahabhuta. And from there emerges, not only at that level, but also at an individual level. This Panchamahabhuta model goes to at our, not only that level, our health level, the planetary level is okay, but also at our Ayurveda system, if you look at it, our Tridosha has come out from Panchamahabhutas. So it is related to, never before I have seen a model by which it can almost impact every aspect of our living and our composition itself. And this model is not just physical model. This Panchamahabhuta is not thinking. I never seen. I'm really amazed how profound this model is at physical level, at biological level, at psychological level. It goes to our mind and consciousness and also spiritual level. It's an extension. I have not seen model coming out to modern scientists which can extend at all levels and all of things. And can explain every phenomenon of that kind. How can I explain my own thoughts, my consciousness? The model that will also explain that. Today we are having problems of understanding the biology. We are understanding problems of how life comes about on this earth or here, this one. Our thoughts, our behavior, our moral behavior, our social behavior, all that model, I think, right face. We need to understand this model, which we are now coming out with the understanding of the coming of the quantum mechanics, understanding how thoughts affect the physical phenomena. So I would like to, I think, one of the things with the young scientists, I would like to, I think, invoke, and also IITM, but when they are looking at the climate issue, it's on a very significant level, this one, computational issue in very significant level, that what is this one kind of thing? How do that our thoughts affect? How do our behavior affect the climate? This one, particularly understanding quantum mechanics, and beyond, going to that level. So this is one research which I would like to do. That's how I think we looked at that living the life of virtue is important. I think nobody has said that we must live the life of virtue, your morality, your ethics are equally important, and that may affect, that do affect our climate and our existence. I think this is one of the philosophical debates which I'm Nalanda have been trying to see. That how did you look at it? How Buddha looked at it? How our Vedic Rishis looked at it? How they related these two things which were not related by modern science until now? Coming to the level of which is, I think, the science behind weather or climate is concerned, we recognize and we started recognizing, I think, early in the mid-80s that we will require high computational power. These models of weather are extremely complex models. The computational fluid dynamics or Navier-Stokes equations or coupled equations and all that kind of thing, and extremely complex system we are looking at, and building these models is very complex, and solving these equations are going to be critical, and we require computing power for that. And we recognize that we will require, like European, the rating, ECMR, WF, we also require supercomputing power for our country, and we wanted that to be like ECMR, WF, we must build, suppose for the India, or NCMR, WF, we must build an institution like that, and that will require a supercomputer. We found that kind of thing that, of course, we don't have supercomputing. Not only that we imagine, that we assume that such supercomputing power will be available to us. And if we get it from Cray, or if we get it from the US, or like Japan was trying to build such a Cray-like supercomputers at that time, but they did not have the, I think, mature softwares, but we then asked from Cray that we will require, and we would like to import one system, system from the US, and we thought we'll get it. To our not only surprise but shock that they were not ready to give that system to us, which was obviously there were several deliberations on that issue in US Congress, that how supercomputing is a very, very powerful strategic resource, and perhaps what they observed that this technology is possessed but only by the US at that time by Craig, this one, and this can be US can use of course for their strategic things, that if you possess and protect that resource, or control that resource, we can almost dominate in technologically, we can dominate, strategically we can dominate the entire world. So it was decided that this will not be, of course, there will be export regulations on supercomputing, and then of course that's what we discovered. They never told that they are not giving it to us, but we were never given this. Years passed, and then it required in 85, we decided that we also require, NCMRW will require, also will require for our IIC scientists came out with the idea that we require now further research, further advancement of science is critically dependent on supercomputing, and they also demanded to the government that if you want to give something to us, give us a current state-of-the-art supercomputers, and that would be the most important position of Indian Institute of Science for advancing the science. So, but then, of course, it was not to be given to India because India could use it. They didn't want to export it beyond US itself. Didn't want to give it beyond US itself. So, but also not control it, if at all, it would be, they may give it to NATO countries, and we have really a strategic resource, and we are struggling with it. It is in this negotiation, I think, remember, Ronald Reagan was the president and was more kind and more compassionate fellow, who was supposed to be this one. And perhaps when he was asked to, the then young prime minister was very, very fascinated by computers and computing at that time, this one. And he said that if you ask, and if there is a high level negotiations at a presidential level, negotiations across the country, perhaps this may be given to us. And when Rajiv Gandhi was traveling to US, and there was going to be Rajiv Gandhi Reagan summit, and at that time a high technology accord was to be signed, and in that thing we demanded for our supercomputer, and then of course several negotiations took place. US agreed, but the actual negotiations, what happened, that they put several regulatory frameworks on that this cannot be used for this, there will be total control, there will be complete this one inspection of what we are doing with it. And though they finally yielded, finally, I thought, we may give a, I think, last previous generation supercomputer in the XMP form, which is something like, whereas YMP was going through, was about computer which can perform billion instructions per second, the gigaflop level supercomputer. So our capability, it may be given to us with several conditions attached to it. So when Mr. Rajiv Gandhi came back, and then of course discussed with the scientists, and I was part of that now, what can we do? Why can't we develop our own supercomputing capability or technology of seeing, as we have done in the nuclear field, and we have done in the space program with Vikram Sarabhai, but I think like that now, why can't we take the initiative and build our own? At that time, I think there is distinguished scientists, and particularly the scientific advisory committee to the PM, I think advised that we must take a national initiative on building. It was here at that time, I think IITM was also advancing, and they started feeling the great need for such a resource. Without that, we could not advance it. I'm very happy. I'm happy to see that from those days, and from those days of great restrictions and regulatory frameworks, etc., we have gone. We've gone ahead as we started building our own technologies. The most important issue that when we started building our own, started designing at many places, we started doing this one. And I remember when CDAC came out in, from 88, CDAC was launched in 88. In the next 3 years, we struggled really how to build this technology. And fortunately, or I think, the parallel processing technology was emerging. So the parallel processing, I was absolutely sure that we cannot build supercomputers of what great design, because we don't do those kind of chip designs, and also we don't know how to build those chips, or we didn't have manufacturing capability of these chips. This one, there was no way we could build the Cray-like systems in India. And I was completely convinced that the only way of building these systems will be the invoking the parallel processing technology that was just emerging. We took on that path. Of course, some other countries also then decided to go same way, and we started building this. 2 years we built, I think first NAL also started building this one, systems of that kind, and we all started building systems of that kind by 1990. I think within 2 years itself, our mission was for 3 years, and we built the system. And I remember the question Rajiv Gandhi had asked me at that time, that can we build? I said I have not seen a supercomputer. They said that they don't want to, they won't give access to see that supercomputer, great supercomputers. But I can tell from inner, I think from intuitive level, because I cannot prove that I can, because we never built, we are not seen, but we'll be able to build, because that's what we did in our nuclear technologies and the space technologies, etc. With some experiences of this one which we had, we built both these technologies. So with that in the conviction, and taking the inspiration from Baba and Sarabhai, we can also build supercomputing, this kind, and he smiled. And then they said how much time it would take. I also did not know how much time we can. We had done some calculations using parallel processing technologies, and because the entire hardware, not only hardware, they had a chip level also. The communication network or the fabric was to be built. This one, operating systems were to be written. Compilers were to be written, because even the compilers were denied to us. So I remember for 8386 and 486 system, this one, the compilers were to be built, and of course applications writing, because we don't know how to use this system. Gray had at that time declared, Samuel Gray himself, the father of supercomputing, he declared that this case, if systems were trying to build at many universities, but you will never be able to use such system, because software writing will be such humongous task that we will not be doing any viable way of using these systems at all. So in that context, we had to learn the parallel processing software and how to write softwares for that, kind of thing, and write in a way of that we can actually solve the problems, how to debug, how to, many things to be done on that, and entire software layers were to be built. So this was a big challenge, I feel, at that time. So one thing, good thing happened that thing, this was that the 90s came, it was being done in the 90s, and we started building this system from ab initio, and that's what I think, building such institutions of like IITM, we start understanding the whole thing at very at fundamental level, things which are very at basic level, which we'll never understand. Suppose we just given the systems to you and start using the system, and just using some way or the other the system at gross level, but we started understanding, and that has led really to building the foundation for the IT industry. You know, I would say that thing which we have built, we started a advanced computing training school. You also have a training school here. This is for understanding weather and teaching the thing to the young generation, coming from your master's level students or PhD level students or postdoctoral students now. So students can be given at a very advanced level, can be really developed at a very advanced level to understand the phenomena, this one, and going forward and doing research which is relevant to our country or relevant to our local needs. So that's how it happened. At that time, I remember one thought, Sam Bitwood, I was just traveling, and he said that you are developing our students, you are developing the school, and we are developing people, and which are extremely important in supercomputing. But the great challenge is going to come now, that we have great opportunity, not challenge, but opportunity is going to come, called Y2K. Suddenly, the world started recognizing that they have not accounted for Y2K, the year 2000 kind of thing, and then we'll have to rewrite the entire software for the whole thing, what was written so far, and there is no way we can rewrite the entire software in such a short time. They challenged me, that challenge told, can we create tens of thousands of software engineers in a very, very short time, which is available to us now, next five to six years. And that, I said, that's a challenge, and that's a great opportunity, which is also a challenge, but also a great opportunity, and we created that. And we really came out the idea of really a software factory, creating the factory of software engineers. This was not known at the time, that I given a top engineer who knows barely some logic and may know computing and may know engineering, this one, but does not know anything about computer architecture and software. So can we develop it? We came out with a course. I think that course was designed, and we wanted to do experiments on that. But the question came, there are no computer engineers, very few in the IITs and some institutions at all, I think, which could be trained as software engineers. Then the question I asked was at that time while walking on the hills here, is that why, who told that only computer engineers can become software engineers alone? It can be any engineer, possibly, or any scientist. Because we were not making engineers of that kind. At all, this would not be possible. So we said that let's try with civil engineers, let's try with mechanical engineers, chemical engineers, whosoever is engineering, let's try with anyone, something, and this cannot be done, we cannot have several years to do that. He has to be coming out with this course or this training, he has to come out as a software engineer. Thus, comes as a software engineer. And this precisely, we came out with this course, 14 hours a day, work hard, and they will be the thing, they will have. Sleeping sometimes, learning a new course. I remember those days, and they started coming out as software engineers. Then the question came, how a chemical engineer can be a software engineer? How a mechanical engineer can be a software engineer? And I asked Mr. Kohli, who was at the time the TCS head, TCS director, that can you try out with this engineer? He said, how can I try? Then I asked him that how can I try as a chemical engineer, as a software engineer in TCS? Then I said, but please ask us, let's pause for a moment. I said, are you a software engineer? I asked myself, am I a software engineer or a computer engineer? We never had computer as a course in engineering at that time, because electronics had just come, we are learning electronics and everything. But we are today, I think, heading software development organizations. If electrical engineer can do it as well, these people also can do this one. And then he said, please try it out, let's try it out. And then when he tried out those outputs, what I was trying to say, that they were writing software better than computer engineers themselves, who were traditionally coming from the IITs or some institutions like that. This was a great realization for us. And suddenly we started creating large number of software engineers. As soon as they were trained, they were sent to US because such urgent was the task was. People, I think the plane, loads of software engineers used to go, and I think we started, our engineers started going to US, and that's how the IT revolution really occurred. What I was trying to say, that's how the IT revolution really occurred. I think you are doing that, we are doing it in many, many fields, this one. A new field, new challenge before us, we start understanding it, and just and transmit to a young generation, and that's what I think today, if you see that, suddenly how these engineers are able to do this petascale computers, or things coming from environmental science, learning physics, chemistry, and fundamental sciences, and then they are able to use these high-performance computers like this very effectively, and actually predict what is the task before this lab or similar labs are to for the world. I just traveled to supercomputing, these conferences which occur every year. And when I go there, I find that these were the engineers trained by us, trained by India, all around there marketing the different booths on different things and developing technologies for that, for different companies. So why I'm mentioning this issue is that the great thing, when the challenges are thrown before a laboratory, before a country, and we rise to those challenges, and one part of India is that we never awaken unless such challenges are thrown before us. I think similarly, I see in IITM, that's from what level we have come to this level as one of the leading, I think, institutions of the world for really addressing the issue of weather forecasting or climate change, or understanding this whole issue, which has become extremely important for the whole of humanity. So I appreciate this, and there's so much to be learned from using these machines. These machines are very tough. These are millions of today's supercomputers like Pratyush time. There are millions of cores, and the whole software has to be parallelized to that final level and actually used to solve problems. That's the challenge which I think I congratulate all scientists that you rose to this challenge, and you are able to use the petascale systems, at least the petascale systems which are before us, which are very difficult to use using parallel processing technologies. And of course, you have to learn mathematics, algorithms. This one, parallel processing ways, the algorithms, using the algorithm effectively so that you can scale these systems and achieve great benchmarks for what we are doing. So my congratulations to IITM. And because you are now not only India's leading organization, but the world's leading organization now in your field. This one, congratulations to young people, girls and boys who have accomplished this feat. This lose confidence for us to go. Because we are talking about that when we go further, now we are going to use this machine, these kind of machines. Computing power has increased by a factor of 1,000 every 10 years. If you see that supercomputing power, every 10 years, we are working with gigaflops. Supercomputers when we started, and then last century ended, we were given a teraflop supercomputers. I think you also started using teraflop supercomputers at that time. And then now the challenge is, by 2010, it became that we will use not teraflop, but the petaflop supercomputers, which are 1,000 times trillions of instructions must be performed. I think they must perform, and we must be able to solve such problems using these structures, computing structure. Now, the challenge before the whole thing, people thought that if it is the fact, like Moore's law, we will have to now build systems of 1,000 times than peta system. 1,000 peta mathematical operations per second systems must be built, and there were many, many challenges to do that. One of the greatest challenges, of course, can you use parallel processing program? Maybe we may be able to do the the parallel processing, massively parallel processing technology, but the question came that will we have, what kind of power they will consume. The calculations that were made in 2010, that if you want to build really the exascale supercomputers, they will require several super thermal power stations to run these supercomputers. This kind of thing, a super thermal power station, which is not viable, which is not, then we may muster such a power, but we will not be able to pay for such power, because there is, I think the cost of running such will be several times more than the cost of supercomputing themselves, this one. And then the challenge began that now it was brought down, not only the supercomputers have to be developed, the power must be from thousands of megawatt, power must be down to something like 20 or 40 or 50 megawatt. That became the challenge in design of such system. Today the challenge is really the power system. One of the challenges is the of course, how to use such systems, which are millions of cores, and we are able to build such structures. We are able to build. This task is going on through the National Supercomputing Mission now, in CDAC and in IIC and many institutions, actually building. No, not just building, but from chip level onwards, the board levels, system level to the different operating systems that will have to be written. This one, at all levels, we are struggling. We're writing, that's how the National Supercomputing Mission was launched. This project is now on, and the Government of India funded, and some way on, actually, there's always an issue of getting, actually making available such money. That, of course, everybody knows, Professor Ravi will know, anything will be promised, and, but anyway, that's not important, but we are building such exascale supercomputers, and using them now, and weather will be the challenge. I think, whenever people ask me, where will it be required? I say, don't underestimate the climate. Climate has been driving really supercomputing technology. Climate has been really driving kind of things. One of the great drivers of supercomputing, and when we develop the exascale supercomputer, or IITM will tell us, or NCMRW or IMD will tell us, this is not enough. The accuracy is not enough, or whatever kind of thing, what you're doing at this level, not enough. So this has been a driver for supercomputing. Anyway, how they are intimately linked with each other. Finally, I would say that this is understanding the depth of, or the beauty of climate will be a great challenge. And I also see that the issue will come, how do we really not understand, but what do we do? Suppose if there is not going to be monsoon or healthy monsoon this year, what do we do is the question. I think IITM has to take that challenge. And you know that you are building seeding experiments, you are doing a lot of things. Basically, whether it should be done or not, there are many issues. But many countries are, of course, working on that. Climate change, modifications, in what manner it should be done, how it will be sustainable, and all those kind of things. But that issue also we'll have to solve. And this issue may not be solved. This is not just a problem of cloud seeding. And they are going to be intimately linked with the human behavior. I personally feel that our Vedic rishis were right, that kind of thing, when they perform that kind of thing, that unless humanity changes the view itself, and climate change we have seen, that unless you have to change your attitudes of the people, that kind of thing. It is the issue of why climate change has occurred such a drastic way. Because we started exploiting nature, and that was a fundamentally wrong, flawed model, that you can't exploit you of which you are part, Mother Nature. That's why we used to worship our Mother Earth, and we show our rivers, we used to worship our mountains, trees, this kind of thing. When that attitude got changed, and suddenly in one century, we brought a case by which whether we don't know, we exploited nature to such extent that we don't know now that whether we will exist, humanity itself will exist or not. This requires a different attitude. This requires a different model of the world to build, which cannot be just physical model, which we have to go at different levels. And that's why I've been insisting that kind of thing, that we have to understand our existence in a very different level, which I think India has shown the way, in the Vedic ways of doing this kind of thing. And once we understand, that's why the science and spiritual aspects must be brought together. Because without that, your attitudes will not change. Without this, we will not look at the world differently. And then we start understanding why these yajnas will be there, why we're worshipping our rivers, why we're worshipping the trees, why we're worshipping the nature itself, Mother Nature. So I think it was a different paradigm shift. I'm sure, I think I would like to say that IITM, showing this way, from maybe this pure science way, science and technology way, will come to this larger, broader wisdom, understanding that kind of thing. The vision the science must provide to the world to survive this planet, to make a beautiful living on this beautiful planet which has been given to us. I think with these words, friends, I am very happy that I came to a great institution which forms the hope for not only for farmers, but also for the nation, but also for the humanity as a whole, giving a different parallel vision to the world itself by understanding climate better way through science, and through also spirituality working together. Friends, I'm very happy that you have called me on this occasion. I wish you all the best. I think the IITM will, I have no doubt, be one of the finest institutions, I think, of the world, because they say you already proven in that direction, or already walking in that direction, and with this, people from the world will come to learn here, to do research here, together with other scientists of the world, and to understand our climate, understand our planet, and understand our universe in a better way. I wish you all the best on this great occasion, and my best wishes. Thank you very much.